Life Fight with Jermaine Andre is a positive production of Rare Gem Productions. For previous episodes or to get new episode updates, subscribe to the Life Fight channel hosted on the Inspiration Network of OneRareGem.com.
That's OneRareGem.com.
For the tools you need to take on your life fight. With U.S. Martial Arts Hall of Famer, two-time world champion, five-time U.S. champion, UFC vet, life coach, and author, Jermaine Andre. Visit JermaineAndre.com.
Hello, everybody. What's happening? It's Jermaine Andre, Life Fight. I'm sitting here with Rebecca Beck.
Hello.
And we're on here. We're on the air again. And today, we're going to cover a few things. I'm actually going to cover some thoughts on my experience with some middle school kids, some high-energy middle school kids that I was called in to train with my MMA skills. So that's going to be pretty funny. And after that, then I'm actually going to give you a lesson on how to put your haters to work for you.
Oh yeah.
And show you the value of having haters, you know. But before we go to that, we're going to read some reviews. I know Rebecca got a couple of reviews she got pulled up that she wanted to go over. So it's all yours now.
All right. This review is from Shoe Is Me. Great way to understand how to change your thinking and get useful tips and tools to help all with day-to-day events. Great stuff, and keep it coming, Jermaine Andre.
Right on. Awesome.
Yes.
You know what I like about what he said in the beginning there? Read that first sentence again.
Great way to understand how to change your thinking and get useful tools and tips to help with all day-to-day events.
And I think changing your thinking is important. Because if we're not constantly changing our thinking, we're not thinking.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? So, and that doesn't mean you have to think a certain way.
Right.
But the whole idea that, like I tell people all the time, we always have to be redefining ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We have to always be learning. We have to always be figuring things out.
Yeah.
You know, one of those things is that can happen, even though we may be learning new things, it may be the way that we learn that's out of whack.
Mm-hmm.
So we may have to change the way that we think, change the way that we learn things to even understand that which we are learning.
Yeah, so. Well, and it's a, you know, that doesn't mean you have to change your religion, or it doesn't mean you have to change the way you treat people. Sometimes it just allows you to even understand how to communicate with certain people because of what you know and what you're learning and what you're thinking. So you don't have to change your way always. You just have to open your mind, and that allow you to be able to communicate a little bit differently with people.
Well, that's a good point. Is sometimes the reason we can't communicate with people is because of the way we think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because of our thinking pattern. Even though we think we're trying to understand a person, you know, it's the way that we won't open our thinking up.
Absolutely.
Think about that one.
Let me read a second review. This one is from Too Many Marbles. It says, Life Fight is chock full of personality and inspiration. Andre and Rebecca do a fantastic job of bouncing off one another while providing insight on that day's topic, whether that be conquering your fears or just discussing some personal traits. The two always make you feel part of the conversation, which is important as a listener. They are really personable. With all that charisma, it helps to drive home the messages that they strive for. Can't read. I've never wanted to succeed more than when Jermaine Andre inspires me to. Life Fight is positive and uplifting, yet still a knockout. I can't recommend it enough.
Oh, awesome. We need to get him to write the, you know, something on our website for us. That was really nice. Right on.
Thanks for the reviews.
Definitely. Thanks. And everybody remember, too, you know, send your reviews in. You know, go on there, to, you know, say what you got to say. Let us know, and we'll read them on the air.
Absolutely. Definitely.
So, moving along to my middle school experience, a school here in St. Louis, in the St. Louis area, was having a deep concern with some youth, and they were just causing such a disruption and distraction in classes that the teachers couldn't even teach the students who did want to learn. I happen to know one of the teachers and the principal, and they've actually just, I've had a program where they brought some, you know, I like to call them high energy, you know, some high energy kids to my academy, and I shut them down, and, you know, immediately, I'm talking about the first minute, they couldn't, the teacher's like, oh, my God, how did you do that? I said, well, first of all, they know I kicked the crap out of them.
you know
what I'm saying? And not literally hurting them, kick the crap out of them. I'm saying, you know, they gonna get some work put on them. But mainly it's the aura of the facility and the way we present ourselves that, you know, got them in check fast. So this teacher remembered that. She had brought me these 20 kids, and it was like, boom, like that.
Right.
So we tried to actually get these kids to come to my school, which we couldn't happen because it was a school year. So they actually got me to come there.
Wow. That's great.
Yeah, it's pretty wild, man. It was quite an experience. Of course, when I went in, you know, these are eighth graders.
Yeah.
So that's that age.
That's that age.
That age. Yeah, where, you know, they're trying to be adults, but they don't want the responsibility
right,
of adults.
Be.
Yeah,
they
got all this new energy. They're trying to impress their friends. You know, they just don't know their position yet in life.
Right.
So first thing is the school I was at, these, I have to say, there wasn't a bad kid in there.
Right.
Very distracting, you know, with me not being able to issue actual martial art discipline and leg kick somebody or hip toss them and slam them on the mat. They could do whatever they want.
Yeah.
You know, because this is the thing. I didn't want to kick anybody out because I was supposed to be the last resort. So it wouldn't do any good to, you know, you need to do what I tell you. I'm going to kick you out. Okay, well, you know, what good, what do you need me for?
Right.
If that's, the teachers could have did that. you know what I'm saying? So they were trying to keep that from happening. So I put myself in this position where Jermaine, you have to figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was Shifu dealing with Kung Fu Panda.
Yeah.
You know, I love that part when, you know, Kung Fu Panda say, you know, how are you going to turn this into the warrior dragon?
Yeah.
And Shifu said, I don't know. You know, and Kung Fu Panda looked at him like, oh, he said, yeah, there's two tragedies here, brother.
Right.
You figuring out how you're going to become the Red Dragon or whatever
the
it was.
Warrior Dragon.
Warrior Dragon to fight, you know, oh, crazy. What was his name? You remember his name? The bad guy.
Yeah, no, I can't. Tigress. No.
No, Tigress is good.
Thailand.
No. Thailand. No, that's where our fight comes from.
Yeah, but it's got
he got a cool name or something. Well, let's keep moving.
Okay.
You know, you trying to figure out how you're going to beat this dude. And I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to train you to do it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You ain't got no confidence in yourself. So that was all. So I put myself in that position that, Jermaine, this is not just a challenge for them. This is a challenge for you.
Mm-hmm.
How good of a teacher are you?
Right.
You know, and there were times, you know, it'd be so disruptive because I tried to get them meditating. I mean, they would do everything. You had people, I couldn't believe how much they would talk. They just couldn't shut up. And it wasn't a thing where they were even trying to be rude. I'd walk over to them, excuse me, ma'am. You got something more important to say than I do? And they, no, sir. You know, and they kind of, as soon as I walk away, with talking to their friend and not in a way where I'm looking and saying they're just trying to be rude, but they really just can't shut up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I'm dealing with this, and it was, you know, it got to a point where there was actually a day where I almost threw my hands up and said, there's nothing that can be done.
Wow.
You know, but then that's when I said, okay, Jermaine, you on the ropes. You get knocked around. And the most important thing that I said is, one, I can't abandon these kids. And two, I can't abandon these teachers. This is what they have to go through.
Right.
Except you muscle bound with a mohawk and a world title belt. So I had the kids' attention for a little while, mm-hmm. until they realized that there was no punishment or disciplinary action for their misbehavior.
Yeah.
Except me, you know, say, hey. And that worked for a little while. You know, woof, woof, mm-hmm. woof. You know, the dog's deep bark. But eventually, woof, woof. It don't mean nothing to you. Yeah, whatever. Shut up. Go sit down. You know what I'm saying? So it started getting to that point with them.
Now I have a question. Did the kids know, the high energy kids, did they know that you were coming in because they were high energy kids?
Yes, they knew they were selected.
Okay.
They knew they were selected. And I clarified that when I walked in that, you know, and they said, why are we in here? Because we the bad kids. And I told them, I said, no. I said, you're not a bad kid. I said, you've got a ton of battle energy and you don't know how to focus it. I'm here to help you focus your battle energy. And when I told them that, they're like, oh. So they were receptive.
What's battle energy?
Battle energy is just, you know, we all absorb, I think I've told the story where we absorb energy every day. You know, good energy, bad energy. You know, you wake up in the morning to your alarm. That's bad energy. You wake up stressed like, mother. And then you got to hold that in.
Yeah.
You know, so that is suppressing, it's stacking. And then you walk downstairs, you smell bacon. Ah, that's good energy, you know. So all day long, you're dealing with this. You know, your boss, oh, man, there's a boss. And you pack that energy on. Well, if you don't release that energy, you know, that's why we say martial art training, sports, things like that. Kids who do that type of stuff, you don't have to deal with the ADD, ADHD, all that kind of stuff because they're releasing that energy. But now all the kids are expected to sit in this classroom for 8 hours a day, eat these horrible lunches that aren't even real food, most of them. And most of the kids are eating potato chips and candy and soda because they don't even understand health and fitness. And they've got this energy that makes them want to explode. That's their battle energy.
Oh, battle energy.
Because and it's energy to fight. You know, we that as human beings are battle-driven beings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we like competition. We like challenges. We like, when you know, that's when we're on this planet. You know, you take a little toddler kid and he gets out there into the world. He's out there. He's wanting to do stuff. He's not just wanting to go hide in a hole and be a, you know, a brown recluse, you know, or something like that. So their battle energy, when I gave them that word, they gave them a positive way to look at themselves. No, you weren't picking, you were bad. You were picked because you got tons of battle energy. And then I gave them my background. And my background is the hardest core background on the planet. So once they heard my background, that shut everybody up.
Right.
And it got their attention. And then when I showed them my fights, they really shut them up. But it only lasted for a few days, you know. And so it had to get to the point because even with, you know, I was walking into one of the classes. I mean, I was in my class and everybody was late coming. And I was like, what the heck? And I heard all this noise in the hallway. And I stepped out in the hallway and it was two kids getting ready to fight. And then the teacher who I was dealing with was trying to stop it. And there was a female security guard there trying to stop it. And, man, I'm trying to tell you, it was a mob.
Wow.
I mean, that was 20, 30 kids on each side.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? It was only two getting ready to fight. But this mob was pushing both ways. I'm looking at this little teacher. You know, I'm like, dude, you know, I'm feeling I got to extract her from in there. This is a gang situation, you know what I'm saying? And these weren't bad kids. This wasn't a gang. They were, you know, wasn't this type of kid. So I'm just saying a point of what these teachers go through when all these parents are saying, they didn't do anything and this and that. And I'm looking, and I said, okay, you're not supposed to touch these kids. But they get ready to start throwing, and the security guard came.
Yeah, I was going to ask, can the security
Can
jump
touch.
In the middle of
Yeah, she can touch. Okay. And the security guard came, and she grabbed one of them and pulled them aside. Well, the other one started moving towards them, and I said, well, first of all, it's a female security guard. I'm not going to let them hit her. You know, so what I did was I went up and I did the bodyguard extraction where I hugged them and walked them off.
Was it boys fighting or girls?
It was boys, two boys.
Two boys, oh.
And I hugged them and I said, be cool, man. Come on, let's go. Be cool. He's like, no, that's it. I know, just be cool. And I talked him down and he calmed down. And he was fine. So I let him go because he wasn't actually in my class. The teacher came and walked him down the hallway and the other ones went into the room. Well, he got into it with another one. They both were in my class. And they started, and then the two sides formed again. So I got 30 kids.
Wow.
So you got 15 on this side, 15 or whatever the number was. And they all just, you know, and I'm touching him. Hey, chill out. Quit instigating. You know, because they all in on it. You know what I'm saying? And so these two kids and the security guards in the middle of them. Hey. And she's trying to shut them down. And one of them swung.
Wow.
And he hit the security guard trying to hit the other guy. And she had great discipline. She grabbed him. Hey, I said, you know, she didn't hit him. She didn't get mad. And I did, at that moment, I grabbed the other kid. You know, just hugged him is what I did. You know, just in a strike. I hugged him and turned him away so he can't, where his energy is not looking at the other guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I turned him away because I wasn't going to stand there and let the security guard get punched in
absolutely.
The face. I said, no way in the world I could stand there and let that happen. But at the same time, I didn't, you know, there was no anger. There was no panic. I didn't feel, I just felt that, I could just hug this kid. And the kids was probably about as big as me. I'm going to tell you that, you know, these eighth graders, they big kids, man. They was muscle-bound, little athlete kind of guys, you know. But when I turned them away, which is what I always try to teach people when you're dealing with two guys great to fight, get them from in front of each other. Make them look the other way where they don't see each other, and they'll automatically, and they can listen to you. Because the problem's out from, they're zeroed in on this problem. Once you get distracted and it creates a brain shock, then you can zero in and, hey man, calm down and bring a calm voice to them, a calm touch and things like that. So
I have a question. What was what were the teachers, what do you think their intention was with bringing you out to these kids? Was it to get them to calm them down
control? Yep. And that's what I even told them. They said, well, why are you here? And I had the kids. I said, you have to ask this. Why are you here? I'm glad you asked it, but why am I here?
That's good that one of the kids asked that. That shows a lot of confidence to ask. That's good.
And then even like I told him, I said, I'm not here to talk down to you. I'm with y'all.
Mm-hmm.
I'm one of y'all. So I'm not here. You're not with me because you're in trouble. But I'm here to teach you how to control your energy because I know what kind of bad things can happen when you don't.
Yeah.
And that's when I told my stories, you know, and they're just like, oh my God. I said, yeah, but you know how many times in my life I was one step away from destroying my life and ruining my life forever. You know, but luckily, I don't know, something, God or somebody is watching over me to stop from happening, but you can make that mistake, you know, and I even had, because the first day I had like these, it was like four or five guys who were serious. They were into it. They were obedient as could be. They were really good. The next day I came back and I'm like, yeah, these are going to be my main guys. And two of them were gone. They got in a fight and got expelled.
Aww.
So they lost their opportunity to be. They wanted to fight. Mm-hmm. You know, because that's the first thing I said. Everybody wanted to fight. I said, because I got mad at them when they all was, you know, oh, we gonna kick it. I said, everybody be quiet for a minute. I said, look, all y'all running around here starting fights with people who don't want to fight and trying to, got these little bitty teachers trying to break you up. I said, look, ain't nothing wrong with wanting to fight. I got your back, baby. Anybody, I got somebody in your weight class. I got somebody in your weight class. And I pointed to all of them doing all that talk. I said, so quit talking and get your mommy to sign the waiver and come out to my school. And if you can't make it there, I know somebody got a school right here and we will get you a fight. So raise your hand if you're ready to fight. Nobody raised their hand. You know what I'm saying? So, but the one guys, they would say that then, that's how respectable they were because they knew I was trying to make a point. But then when I walked off, they pulled me over. Sir, can you really give me a fight? So you better believe it, man.
Right.
I said, we can, if you want to do it, you can be a champ just like me. I ain't no better person than you are. They're like, I want to do it. But then he got into a fight and got expelled. So I say, you know, I said, see how he ruined his chance at that with me. You know, all this was covered. He was going to be with me for a week and he would have been taken care of. Now I ain't going to even know who he is anymore, you know, because he got into a fight and got expelled from school, you know? And so it was setting examples like that, but.
So it sounds like it's super important that you came in and you kind of were really real with them. Because I think the one of the big issues with kids is they still look at teachers and authority as, you don't really get it. You don't get it. You don't know what I'm going. You're just my teacher. And that's what they think a lot. They think that they're not even looking at them and saying what's going on in your life because they don't have time for that. So it's good to bring in somebody like you who can not focus just on their schoolwork and say, all right, what's going on here?
Right.
You
just
know,
being real with them.
Right. What's going on in your life? What's in training and all that kind of stuff kind of brings that out in them. So,
well, you know, one of the things they was doing in there a lot was cussing.
Yeah. Wow.
And I was surprised because I heard one of them cuss out the librarian. The librarian, they were in a room they weren't supposed to be in. She told them, you guys need to get out of here. Mm-hmm. And she said, F you, bruh, don't be talking to me. Blah, blah. And I was like, and I almost grabbed her by her neck. You know, who you think you talk to like that? You know what I'm saying? Old school. You know, I was like, and I looked in the librarian just embarrassed.
Wow.
And I almost cried. Mm-hmm. I mean, that broke my heart. I'm like, and then I turned to the kids because my kids were in there. I said, do y'all talk to the teachers like that around here? Y'all allowed to do that? And then the dude, it was all the boys said, that's the girls that be doing it. These girls always be talking like that to people. I was like, I said, that's horrible. I said, do you know what happened to me back in the, I would have got my teeth knocked
yeah.
out.
Oh, yeah.
By the teacher, the principal, my parents, then the cops would have came mm-hmm. up and beat me up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, I would have punched myself in the mouth. So it was really, really heartbreaking. But when I heard them cussing in the class, I was going back to us. That first thing I'm going to do is I got to show them my respect that this is their home. Because we ain't in my dojo. You know, or else I'm not going to be able to connect with them. I'm just another teacher. And they 2 weeks away from getting out. They ain't trying to hear that. So when I let them do a little cussing until somebody finally dropped the F-bomb. I said, everybody hold on a second. I said, did I just hear an F-bomb? Oh, no, no. I said, no. I said, look, guys, I cuss sometimes. I said, but listen to me. Cuss words hold power. What does a curse word mean? And they're like, oh, you know, I said, curse. You're putting a curse out.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're doing it, you're using magic. It controls emotion. I said, so don't just put it out there. Because if I tell you, sit down and shut up, and I did that, they all kind of flinch. But if I say, sit down and shut the F up, you know, and I didn't use the F word. But I said that, and I said, is there a difference between the two? And he's like, yeah.
Yeah.
I said, so hold that as power. Don't just be out there, man, mother F and baby, because you heard on the rap. So,
yeah.
And they, oh.
Right.
And the cussing lowered down. And wow. That was the same thing even with the N word. They was dropping that. Oh, blah, blah, blah. I said, hold on, who used that word? I said, let me teach y'all about that word. So I went all the way back. And there's a lot of them that didn't know about slavery and the way that word was used and how black people took that word and turned it into a good thing for us. And then how now everybody else wants to, you know. And when mm-hmm. I told them that, I said, but you got to be careful using it because you say that word. You know, yeah. I said, I'm going to tell you the truth. When I'm with my boys, the word might come out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we sitting there hanging or something, it might pop out. I said, but I would never say that around my mother. I said, you got a white teacher in here.
I was just going to ask that. Just curious. But how did the teacher respond? How does the teacher?
They don't.
Oh, they don't. So they just absolutely don't.
That's the point they're at where it's not going to do any good.
Oh, wow.
The kids ain't going to listen to because what happened is you'll pull two here and talk to them. And then these 10 over there do something worse.
Mm-hmm.
So you like a, I told them a theory I gave the teachers. I said, called a pinball theory. I said, the teacher's like a pinball in there. Bing, bing, bong, bong, bing.
Yeah.
You just bounce around dealing with each, trying to put out little fires and nothing gets accomplished.
Yeah. Well, hopefully with everything that you went through with them, that you set the tone on the way that they even can just look at an authority, you know, on how to respect them, how to treat them. So,
well, I did some things that worked.
Yeah.
I hit that point where I said, man, I don't know. It's just, what can you do?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because then I said, okay, the first thing you need to do, Jermaine, is calm down, you know,
yeah.
Which is what I was teaching them. Breathe. So your thinking comes back. Don't go into a panic. You know, don't give up. It's just like a fight. You getting blasted. You just got hip toss. Ron June just hit you with the right hand. You know, and he throwing knees on. You know what I'm saying? Adrian Serrano just put the chokehold on you. So calm down. So what I did, I stepped back from far so I could observe.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked and I saw three different classes. I saw the group of people who were sitting there quiet trying to wait for everybody else to shut up. And they were doing what I was asking them to do. Then I seen the middle group. And they were kind of like the yo-yos. They can get pulled in each direction. But then I seen the high, super high energy group that was, you know, a smaller group. And they were pulling the middle group with them. So I said, we need three separations. So I let the teachers know. I said, I need to separate them into these three groups. This is what's really cool. Is this wasn't just a Jermaine Andre effort, just so you know. There was a lot going on with splitting classes, escorting, all there were a ton of these teachers were playing parts. So it took a village to make this happen. It was the teachers, you know, several principals to make this one thing happen. But I let the main teacher and the principal know that I need these three separations. I said, this is what I see. And she's like, wow. And she said, I see what you're talking about. So the next day, she had a list with these three separations, and she picked exactly who I would have picked.
Wow,
it was incredible. Wild. I said, this is exactly how I would have separated mm-hmm. them. And so we brought them in, separated like that, and everything went exactly like I thought. The kids who would be considered the bad kids, the super high energy, who were so disruptive that you couldn't stop them, they were some of the best. They did the best. I put them in meditation, taught them their breathing drills, just like we do at the academy, and I put them through the controlled breathing. I taught them that, look, when you're afraid, when you're confused, and you respond, your intelligence drops.
Yep.
So you have to stop and breathe. and that relaxes your nervous system and your brain kicks back into action. Mm-hmm. Then you can see better options. So I said, you guys sit there and I want you quiet. I want you to snap, da, da, da. And so they're sitting there, they're thinking, and it's nice and quiet. And I took two chairs and wow, I slammed these chairs together. Wow. The teachers all flinched. These kids didn't flinch.
Hmm.
They didn't flinch one bit. And I went back next to them. Blah, I slammed. And they didn't flinch. And this was the problem ones. Yeah, ones. And I don't like to use those words, but the ones who were causing the distractors.
Gotcha.
I nicknamed them disruptors is what I nicknamed them. I said you had the potentials, the in the middles, and the disruptors.
Okay.
So it worked perfectly fine. So everything went well. We even got to the point where a couple of them had the waiver sign. I gave one kid a leg kick in front of everybody, and he just loved it because it shed his leg down. Yeah. He couldn't walk. You know, I took a girl who was really so super shy, and you could tell she was just so closed off, and taught her the leg trip sweep. And then I let her do it to the guys. She just, these dudes are flying all over and bow, boom. And she's like, and it opened her up. You know, I taught her wrist grab escape. It was so funny because I don't want to do this. I said, look, let me show you this. And what? Why? And next thing you know, they're over here and the teacher fell in with the principal was doing, you know, so it went really, really well. So we're trying to work it to where we can actually bring them to my dojo next, you know, because then I can really put it on.
Well, it's really good to have that separation, I think, for a couple reasons, you know, because it's not fair for the people who are trying to learn that they have to go through all that with the people who aren't trying to learn. And secondly, it's important for the people who aren't trying to learn, what you call the distractors or the disruptors, to even have the privilege to be in the room with the people who are trying to, to learn. So that separation was good.
Because I needed to empower the ones who wanted
to
learn. And so that was the first thing I did. I need them alone.
Mm-hmm.
So when everybody else walks in, they're standing online like military.
Yeah.
And then they're going to look and say,
wow.
What?
Yeah.
And then and that's one of the things I did. I said, when everybody's being disruptive, I said, okay, you. Remember what I taught y'all the other day? Because what I would do is I would keep the good ones or the potentials afterwards for an hour. And I show them stuff. I said, go pull a mask out and go work on your headlock escape. Yes, sir. They go over there. And then I just sit back.
Yeah.
And everybody started looking. What are they doing? Mm-hmm. What you don't get to learn because you got more important things.
Yeah.
I told y'all, this is your school. This ain't my school. You want to talk and hang out? Go for it.
Yeah.
You know, hey, here's some candy.
Yeah.
And you guys, once y'all get that down, dude, I need 20 out of you. Understand me? Then give me 50 push-ups. Then after that, I'm going to show up and we're going to keep moving. Yes, sir. Okay. So that sucked them in. The disruptors needed that opportunity to see that. Because like I said, the only thing I was looking at was there's something more interesting going on in the room than what I'm able to do. So I said, I have to have some role models that they know who can show it. How'd you learn how to do that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, by shutting up and listening to Jermaine Andre, you know. And then that's what ended up happening. So it ended up turning out like that. And like I say, and the ones who many people would have given up on turned out to be some of the best ones.
That's great.
You know, they just, they 180 and they flipped, you know, and they're excited. They're looking at me, they're smiling, they're having a good time. Like there was this little bitty kid who, you know, and I'm looking at, he was so disruptive, he was driving me crazy, but he wore glasses. He was little. I'm talking probably 70 pounds, you know, and he's an eighth grader. So, you know, he getting drove.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, I can't give up on him no matter what he does. Because once I show him a martial art move, you know, and I made a point, and we were talking, everybody, he kind of stand in the back, and he would always do something to get attention. Because the way that works, when you're that small, you're going to get attention because everybody's joining, picking, oh, you little bitty. So what they do is they act out to create their own attention and kind of guide the attention that they're receiving.
Yeah.
So I'm not getting put down. Now I'm just a class clown. Mm-hmm. So everybody leave me alone because I'm doing something. You know what I'm saying? So I can see that happening with him. And so when I was talking to him and I was showing everything, I said, the martial arts was created by little bitty people. And everybody like, really? I said, yeah, like people like your size. And that really, he said, what? I said, yes, people like your size. This was created so people your size could beat up people like me. And he's like, really? I said, yeah, this is made by little bitty guys, man. So that made him feel cool to be a little bitty guy.
Absolutely.
So then I say, so you really need to be studying this. This is your type of stuff. Oh, and once I showed him the leg trip sweep, he grabbed the big athlete. Come here, man. Come here. Oh, man. Come on. Not me. But that connected them.
Mm-hmm.
And then he did it to a boom. This big old football playing dude about my size. You know, boom. He gets up, man. He look how he threw me like that. You know, not a little guy. He's got power. So now he can shut up. Now he can listen. So it worked out so perfect. And that's where I feel that this type of training should be a part for kids today. You know, and not that like I didn't teach him any hitting, you know, no punching, no kicking, anything like that. Just all grab escapes. And then a leg trip sweep. Because I said, look, guys, you know, I'm watching you guys. You're out there, get ready to get into fights. And what's the only thing you think you can do? Punch him. Because you don't know anything else. But you can do this right here. Grab his wrist. Grab his shoulder, put this foot behind, and he ain't going to hit the ground hard. You hold him as he goes down. But he's on the ground going, what did you just do to me? You know, you said, you better behave or else. That gives you another option.
Back to earlier when you're talking about separating them, something that I think is super important, which I just thought it was great that they got separated. But on the role model tip, we teach this to our youth. We like to call our youth community leaders because we train them to the point where we trust that they can go and be this certain role model. So the role models are super important, especially in like middle schools and stuff, because you have to have that sense of comfort that when you're gone and when there's teachers that aren't around, that you have this group of kids that will control the other kids, the disruptors, right, just by leading by example. So having a crew of kids that are the role models is super important in situations like this. So I'm really excited that you got an opportunity to separate them and train them by themselves.
Yeah, and to add to that, when I got them separated to the three different classes, the potentials, the in the middles, and the disruptors. I mean, it was so intense there because I bought all this water to bring in because I'm training them. And it was so intense that I could never leave the room before they got separated. And I had a teacher and a principal sitting there with me. But it was so uncontrollable that I said, I can't walk out of this room. It's going to explode. And so I never could go get them water. But when I got them separated to the three, the potentials, and it was probably about nine of them, I could leave that room, take two of them to the car with me, make one wait in the hall. And it was so beautiful because I say, all right, I'm going to make a move. Y'all got it for me? Yes, sir. So lock this door. Don't let nobody in. Yes, sir. And I take two with me and we would run marching. They'd march with me. So the teachers look out and they hear this. And we run into the car because we ain't wasting no time. Boom. I grab a pack of water. Boom. Hit them in the stomach with it. Boom. And I take a guy and a girl. I always say I need a strong guy and a strong girl. You know, and I remember when I first said that, the girls kind of look like, what? He's acknowledging. And one of them was like, oh, me. And she was dope. Boom. Hit it when she grabbed that water. I said, let's move. And they vroom, running this step way. We running back for bringing the waters in. And usually the ones be waiting by the door. And they open the door, close the door. And they were just perfect. Yeah. You know, and that just showed. But these were some of the kids who the disruptors could have brought all the way down. Where what was happening that I seen in the beginning was, man, won't y'all shut up? You playing too much. You shut up. You don't tell me what to do. What? Now, he get into a fight. Yeah. Now, he's expelled. Right, and it's because he was trying to learn.
Yeah, right.
He was trying to learn. He was sick and tired of this one messing everything up, you know. But then I'm looking and saying the reason he messing everything up, because he half your size, and he gets picked on every day.
Right.
So everybody's got to get that equal chance. That's why I always said, I can't kick anybody out of here. Mm-hmm. It's got Jermaine. You got to figure it out, or you're not a good teacher, you know. But the main thing is that what I saw that these teachers have to deal with, and I still had my secret weapons was the waiver. I could always shut everybody down. And the teachers don't have that where I say, look, all this tough talk mean nothing. If you think you tough, have your mommy sign a waiver and come out to my. Because I remember somebody said one time, ain't nobody scared of you. And I said, hold on a sec. Who said that? I said, wait a minute. I said, no, remember what I told you. I'm not here to hurt you or intimidate you. We talking for real.
Right.
You shouldn't be afraid of me. I'm not in here to beat up eighth graders. You don't have to cage fight me here. I said, so you're right. Yeah, ain't nobody afraid of me. Don't be afraid of me here. I said, now let's talk for real. Have your mommy sign a waiver, come out to my school, get in the cage with me, stand across me in my cage, and say it to my face in my cage. You know, and it got dick.
Right.
And I said, I'm not saying what's going to happen, but I dare you to have your mommy sign a waiver, bring it out there, get in my cage with me, and you say to me you ain't afraid of me and see what's going to happen. Everybody.
Yeah.
So I always had that weapon to shut them down. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because they couldn't say nothing to that. Those teachers ain't got that. They can't say that, hey, shut up or sign a waiver and I'm going to kick your butt in my skin. You know what I'm saying? It's just, would you stop? Would you, you know, and then you expel and suspend. And this one thing, a lot of parents say, well, just kick them out. When you suspend and expel somebody, you just created a problem for the community. Because if they're not getting education, they're out there, they're going to start hanging with the gangs.
Doing the bad stuff.
They're going to start getting now that's the guy that's breaking into your house 5 years from now. He's going to rob you in 5 years.
Yeah.
Or rob your kid, you know, so you still can't just give up on people and say, just throw them in the trash. Now, that trash is going to overflow, and it's going to come back into your neighborhood.
Right.
You know?
So sometimes that's where you wish they'd almost make like I know they do in-school detention and stuff, but I think in-school detentions are so they're not really paying attention to the kid. They just know that this kid's in trouble.
Just make them sit.
So instead of suspending them and stuff, you'd almost like to see the in-school detention be a class where the teacher's saying, you know, hey, I'm going to focus on you and make sure that I get you right to get back to that class.
Well, and that's the idea that these the teachers and the principals who are dealing with me have. They actually said, we need to start a program. Like, well, you're the director. And that's what we do. You know, because I had a lot of in-school suspension kids in there. Now, all of the kids weren't in-school suspension kids. They were just the high-energy kids.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's what it should be. You know, you're going to see Mr. Andre. You know what I'm saying? And when you come see me, it's a black sweatsuit out there in the hot sun, the rain, or whatever. And we working out. Because the difference is, with the martial arts, you can bring pride to their discipline.
Yeah.
It's not just you getting punished. It's now you're somebody. and you better not screw up or you're going to mm-hmm. upset me and you're going to upset everything you're becoming. You're at this rank, just like we do at the school. You know, I say the white belts have no name. You know, everybody gets a nickname because I don't want to know your name. You ain't done crap. You're nobody. You're scum. You know what I'm saying? That's what you want them to feel like.
Right.
And then when they get that yellow belt, congratulate. What's your name? You know, like we had a kid get the yellow belt last night. Now he's walking past. He's like, see, Master Chief. I said, hold on a second. I said, did you just get your belt? Yeah, yes, sir. I said, my man, what's your name? You know, and you can see him like, I said, yeah, you somebody now, baby. Good mm-hmm. job. And I fist bumped him. He like, so now he's got
changed.
Pride. Yeah, everything changed. Now he's gone. So now, and I got that on him.
Yeah.
You a yellow belt. Why are you acting like that? Don't you act like that. What's wrong with you? You want to lose your belt? No, sir. Will you be able to proudly take your discipline and go give me 500 push-ups on your knuckles today? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Whatever we call out. So that's what it'll allow in that school. Just like one of the kids hit me on Facebook from the school. And he said, sir, where's the summer training program from the middle school? And I said, man, we're working on it. We're trying to get it together. We're trying to get busing to try to get them bust out here because they all from, you know, far away. And I'm in St. Peter's. I said, but the whole thing is what I need you to do is I need you guys to behave so I can make this happen. He said, yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That's that right there. Just that little bit of communication. He's feeling proud about who he is where he don't have to act a fool in front of these clowns because I'm with Jermaine Andre.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to learn this stuff. And I think when you give him something like that, and the martial arts is so cool that anybody can learn it. You know, like I say, even if they're in a wheelchair, I can still teach you some martial arts. Mm-hmm. If you got hands that can move, I can show you stuff where you can say, hey, I'm a martial artist. And Jermaine developed the actual technique for people in a wheelchair to use their hands and use throws and grabs and roll over your foot, you know, for a brain shock. So you got something to defend yourself with. And then that gives a person a sense of pride.
Yeah,
you
absolutely.
Know, because human beings just want to belong. You know, we all want to be secure and accepted.
Yeah.
And once you feel like you're accepted by something that gives you an opportunity to become something, you know, and may turn your life into something, then you start behaving because you fit in, you know, and that's what I saw a lot of.
Good stuff. And saying all of that, I was going to read an article today, but I think I probably know the answer to your question. But there was a science teacher that was suspended for using jammer to shut up the students' cell phones because they were being so disruptive. So
he used a jammer to jam their phones in class.
He actually got suspended from the school
FBI coming after
for
him.
Doing it. So, and I was going to ask you, what you think of that.
Well, in relation to, first of all, oh my goodness, cell phones for kids. I don't know why they even let them bring them in
classrooms. I didn't even know they did let them bring them in classrooms.
They used to didn't.
Yeah.
You know, they used to didn't. You know, but I did that one time. I called my daughter. And it was, you know, I don't pay attention to the time of the day. And she asked her, Dad, what are you doing calling me? I said, why would I
not call
you?
What are you doing answering the phone?
Yeah. And I said, what's going on, baby? What you doing? I'm in school. I said, oh, well, you in the locker room? No, I'm in class. I said, what are you doing on the phone in class? What? I said, they let you have your phone in there? Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Well, get off the phone.
That's wild.
I said, just call me back. She said, well, I didn't know if you needed. I said, get off the phone. So it's okay. And when I would, like, when I was up there at this middle school, they all have phones. And it was a distraction because the main thing that happens is, you know, they won't be talking on it, but they'll be Googling and they find something cool. So, and they show it to everybody else.
Wow.
And everybody else. And if you don't look, you ain't a cool kid.
Yeah.
You know, if I say, look at this. And you're like, man, I'm trying to pay attention. Man, forget you then. You know what I'm saying? Now, that's going to be a street fight later.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So that's where I say you got this thing where you either on the bully side or the victim side.
Yeah,
so the kids can't even behave who want to, or else you're going to end up at war. You know what I'm saying?
Now,
the kid who got expelled and kicked out of school was the good one.
Yeah.
He was trying to listen to you, and he got into a fight with the ones who wasn't. You know what I'm saying? So it's a big distraction. So what I started doing was having cell phone check-in. What I did was I bought Lifesavers, candies, and breath mints. I said, everybody bring your cell phone up. Check it in, and you get some candy. They all did it.
Wow.
There's all these high-energy kids.
So if they turn their cell phone into you, they got candy.
Yep. I put a sticker on, I put it in my bag, and sealed all the cell phones away, and I gave some candy.
Right,
so they were, like I said, they were pretty good kids.
Yeah.
You know, and I think you had maybe one or two who would keep their cell phone, but they wouldn't pull it out because they knew they weren't supposed to have it. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Well, so, then they were the oddballs then. So.
Right, exactly. Yeah, they were the oddball. They didn't even let the other kids know that they had it.
Yeah.
Because they didn't want the other kids pointing them out as a liar.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all you like is I said, no one has a cell phone, correct? And everybody knows that lying is the weak way. That's what weak, scared people do is they have to lie. They have to hide. And we don't have no weak people in here. Everybody in here, people with courage and confidence, so I can't deal with you, right? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So the one who's being a coward, and he over there by himself. So now I shut him down. You know, if you don't want to obey, that's fine. But now he's shut totally down.
Mm-hmm.
So
I was wondering what you were doing to all that candy.
Well, I wasn't eating it.
Uh-huh.
I was not eating it.
What did you say? There's about 20 kids in class? And I bought you about a bag of 64. And you never came back with it. What's going
Look,
on?
That's because I let them raid it a couple of times. I told them, everybody get what you want. Leave me some. That was the dumbest thing I ever did. It wasn't nothing left. But keep moving along.
That's a good tactic.
Well, as far as I'm using a jammer, I think the only problem with the
now,
jammer.
Now, what's the jammer? The
jammer shuts, well, it'll shut down your signal where you can't use the phone, you can't make calls, you can't do anything with
so
the phone.
So a teacher can, what is it
you
though?
You can probably find that at Radio Shack.
Oh, so it's like a device that yeah. the teacher went on.
Like
an
electronic device that probably looked like this and you turn
it
on.
Okay, okay.
It just said where you can't use the phone in there. It sends out a signal. You know, now I think the only problem I would see with that is controlling the range. Now the classroom is however big, you know, 40 by 40 feet or whatever. And the range on that might be quarter of a mile.
Oh yeah.
So now you just shut down everybody's cell phone in the building and an emergency happens, somebody trying to call 911 or something like that, and now, you know, they can't do it.
Yeah.
So that's probably why you got in trouble for it. Like I said,
I was gonna say it's always deeper than you think. Yeah.
Yeah, the FCC ain't gonna play that. You can't be out there scrambling, shutting down people's cell phone. That can consider a terrorist act. Mm-hmm. And that's how the FBI would respond to that.
Yeah.
You know, hey, we got somebody shutting down cell phones in this area.
Oh wow.
They'll come in with guns, and they should. We look up, we sitting there, all our phones ain't working and theirs ain't working. Mm-hmm. It's time to lock and load.
Right.
What's going on, man? You know, that'll create a panic. You know, so.
Well, the whole point still is just to show that this teacher
that
got
so
fed
bad.
Up. Yeah, he couldn't even deal with it. So, you know, he's not even not allowed to give these kids proper education because he's dealing with so much garbage on the outside.
Right.
So,
and it is disruptive, you know, to listeners out there. I'm telling you right now, because there was another incident where a teacher took a kid's cell phone and a kid attacked him and body slammed him to take his phone back. And the teacher was like 60-something years old. So,
wait, the kid attacked the teacher? Oh,
yes.
Wow.
Because the teacher took, he was being disruptive with his phone. Well, a lot of people will say, well, why did he take the phone? It's not that big. And I'm telling you, as a person who went in and was teaching, cell phones are extremely disruptive in the classroom.
Yeah,
you
they
know,
are.
It throws everything off. Because even as a teacher who's trying to teach the mind, you have to set a tone to get everybody in a certain rhythm with you, where they're listening, they're flowing. You know, that's just like when I was putting everybody in meditation. You know, and I'd be, all right, everybody, five deep breaths in, out. And I mean, these kids were wild. I'm telling you, these kids so bold, they would just fart. I'm serious, man. I'm like, y'all got girls in here. And the dude just, you know, and then, of course, when that happened, oh, man, you. And so I'm like, all right, everybody move. All right, look, come here. Don't do that in here. And he wasn't even embarrassed. You know, when I come back, you didn't do that in front of girls.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? With the fellas, maybe. But I'd be like, you know, and the girls, oh, you stink. He'd be laughing. He got some attention, you know. So that's the whole thing is, and it ruined the flow.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that everything I was building for meditation at that moment is dead. And a cell phone can do that. Teacher's trying to teach you, blah, 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 and blah, 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 and math. And you would have to, and when you multiply, then, hey, look at this. Guys, you need to stop making all that noise over there because now the people who were listening, you just lost them.
Well, I wonder why they even allow it. Why do they allow phones in classrooms now?
That's weird. I don't think they need them.
Yeah.
I agree. I think they should. I think it should be a rule. You know, you pull your cell phone out, you go in detention. Mm-hmm. You know, you shouldn't even be allowed to have it in the classroom with you. Leave it in your locker. Lock it up.
Hmm. Okay, so I think this is pretty funny. I was in your office the other day.
What are you doing in my office?
You got all your books. Your books out. You know, you've written a lot of books. Oh my gosh, you've written a lot of books. But you know, you got all these self help and educational and inspirational books, and then there was this little book hidden in the back that I don't even think that you've ever even told me that you've written. I think it's hilarious. It's called Dealing Effectively with Idiots. So I just want to pick one out, and actually I'm gonna ask Bill to pick which one he thinks would be the most interesting.
Now hold on a second. I didn't even say you could read that book. Oh. That's what you call a venting book.
Oh, it was hidden for a purpose.
That's probably when
it's
I was
hilarious.
Dealing with a whole bunch of idiots in my life.
I read it while I was sitting in your office.
Well, you got to describe the cover to the listeners
because
on the cover, what I've got is a picture of me, and I've got a bandana on, a leather coat, no shirt, and some duct tape open out. And what I'm doing is like I'm getting ready to duct tape your mouth because I know this is the way that we would like to deal with idiots. It's to duct tape you and beat the crap out of you. So I said that's the way we all want to deal with idiots. But here's some other alternatives to dealing
funny.
With idiots, because as a martial art instructor, I'm supposed to teach you how to do things a smarter way, blah blah blah, all that. So that's why I put this little book together. It's a fun book.
It's pretty fun.
Would you be a pick?
So we're gonna start out with this one, or not start out. We're just gonna do one today, but it's The Smelly Person. So let me pull.
Now this is gonna be the funny part. We got to see if I use this tactic or not.
All right. So it's just one page. I'm going to read it real quick. It's dealing effectively with the smelly person. And it says, the idiot's objective. It's sad to say, but most people who smell badly may not even know it. It may not be their intention to be offensive, so this creates an awkward situation. This has to be handled with extreme sensitivity due to the possibility of him innocently not knowing it. So it says counter technique, which I think this is hilarious that you have a counter technique towards these people. It says always confront the individually privately. Offer a fun story regarding a moment when you were told by someone that you smell badly. you needed a stick of gum, or your hair was messy, your clothes didn't look so great, and you weren't working to the best of your abilities. The idea is to break the ice of the topic and focus the attention towards you. Then explain how you really appreciate the person informing you instead of allowing you to continue to perform the mishap and be ridiculed behind your back by others. Once the individual is nodding to your tune, then it's good to inform him that, you notice how you put him.
Yeah,
him,
it's always guys.
That you're simply watching his back by informing him that his hygiene is a little off. So this is great. This book was great. You've got all these different, you know, like the arrogant prick, the never-ending name dropper, and you have an actual counter technique to all these people. So,
well, and if you can see, the cool thing is, too, when I wrote it with sense.
Yeah, you did.
Because I was getting ready to clown.
Yeah.
You know, when I wrote that, I was getting ready to clown, and I said, Jermaine, you can't do that. It's your job as a teacher to teach people correctly.
Yeah.
So I had to discipline myself and say, okay, I got to give good stuff. And that's one of the main things, too. Like, and that is a tactic I use.
Maybe
we just dealt with that in the school with some people smelling bad. And it's never the ladies. We haven't had a lady come in there stinking yet. It's always the guys.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the first thing I did always do with my stories. I say, guys, you know, we all can stink. What you're doing is your pores are pushing all the toxins out. And I said, and you know, sometimes I stink. I said, there's times I'm walking through the office upstairs in my favorite shirt, and Rebecca will say, take that shirt off now. It's going in the trash.
It's
and I'll
gone.
Be like, what? You ain't taking it, man. And I'll say, I can't even smell myself, you know, and everybody will laugh, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, but she'll have to, and she'll take all my clothes, throw it in the trash, and give me new stuff. I'm mad because, first of all, I hate wasting money, you know. I say,
yeah,
but
they got to go.
But that's what happens. So, and you know, guys, and I say, if you ever smell me stinking, don't let sensei run around stinking.
Yeah.
You better tell me I stink before I walk up to a new customer and oh, man, your Master Chief stinks. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I put it like that, and then that makes it where it's more now, it's almost fun to find each other stinking.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so.
No, so this good stuff. I thought it was going to be silly, and when I read it, and you actually have counters
to deal
with these type of people, it was really good stuff.
And that's why it's called Dealing Effectively.
Yeah.
With idiots, you know. So it's, and you know, we're gonna have you every podcast read something
read
from
one.
It because there's it's good stuff in there. It's real good stuff. I really, you know, went into discipline and focused myself to give good answers where it can help people while they're having fun with it.
I bet that there's one that you missed in here though.
What's that?
I bet something that has to do with what you are is not.
What's that?
I don't know. I'll have to think of it.
Well, I mean, you got what kind of idiot am I?
I'm just kidding.
And actually, I mean, if we got time, I can prove you wrong on that. Would you like me to?
No, there's too many.
No, it's going to be one that I'm going to read.
Wait, but you can't pick the trait about yourself that
yes,
you
I can.
Think it is.
That's
I
how
have
good
to.
I am.
No.
That's how good I am. Oh, you want to pick one about me?
No, I'm saying I have to pick one that's not in there.
I'm saying I have one in there that covers something about me.
Oh, you're saying one's in there about you.
Let me have it. I'll read it.
I bet you I can pick it.
I mean, you might want to be careful because you might pick something that's not in. I'll be like, what the? You want me to pick it?
Yeah, I saw one in here about a boss. About dealing what kind of your boss
but that
is.
Might be one. That might
I'm
be
just
one.
Kidding. All right,
you know, if you want to read the one about the boss, go ahead. Because I think, now, here's the funny part. Okay. Idiot subject number 50. Because I have numbers for these. Didn't I ask you not to bend? This is my only copy.
Sorry,
you
probably,
destroyed this
it's
book.
It's probably mine now.
Idiot subject number 50.
I mean, you had it sitting in your office for like 2 years, so.
Yeah, I know. It's about time to come out, I guess. The biggest idiot in the world. Objective to convince his or herself that everyone in the world is an idiot besides him. Counter technique to first recognize that this person is ourself. Ouch. Then we must learn to be as tolerant as possible and understanding of the person who we are looking at as an idiot before we become judgmental and labeling them as one. Think of things such as, if I was in this position, would I act like that also? Maybe I would even act worse. Maybe he's handling his personal situations better than I could, and I would be a total idiot if I had to walk in his shoes. We must then turn our eyes to look within and see how many times we have done the idiotic things that I have listed in this book. We've all been idiots at one time or another in our lives due to emotional stress, confusion, greed or instant gratification, love, jealousy, ignorance, influence, and haste.
I forgot about that.
So that's
one
that fits me.
Well, yeah. All right. You just shut me down. That sucks. So good stuff. I love books like this, though, that I can just throw in my purse.
Yes,
and every once in a while, I just can open it and read one, and that's it.
Well, I mean, you know why I made that book that size, don't you?
Huh.
Because you told me about that.
Oh.
Remember, you said, your book's too big. Man, I used to make them all big and fancy. You was like, nobody wants this. Jermaine, nobody's going to. We want something we can throw in our purse. I was like, whatever. So yeah. I made that one like that.
I don't know why you hid it in your office for 2 years. Maybe you just thought nothing. I don't know.
Like I said, I got so many books.
I'll read some more in future podcasts.
Right,
stay tuned.
And one of the things that I know I said in the beginning that we were going to cover was how to employ your haters. that we're going to cover today. But that's actually a whole nother podcast. You know, we don't have time to get into it. So
yeah, we don't want to rush that one.
No, so. Definitely not. Because I know everybody's like, what? How do you do that? Kind of goes along with dealing effectively with idiots. But so we'll next on the next one. We definitely will be, you know, that'll be what covers. I'm going to show you how to employ your haters.
I want to hear that.
All right, listeners. Well, once again, we're finished up. And remember, please, please check us out on iTunes, Stitcher. Go leave a review. We read the reviews on here. And like I said, I want things that get us thinking. Any questions, topics you'd like me to cover, and most importantly, people you'd like me to interview. Don't hold back. You'd be surprised who we can get on here. Of course, we're trying to vent things out and get you to get our heads clear and clean out the kitchen before we start bringing somebody else new on, because all that happened, I'll be cutting them off and talking over them. You know, they'd be like, who got interviewed there, Jermaine or him? You know, so we're trying to get it all what we can out, but put down our, you know, any kind of guest you'd like to hear from, you know, and we'll do everything we can to get them on here.
Absolutely.
So good seeing you. Hearing from you again. Are you hearing me? And we'll hear you next time. I'll see you next time.
Bye.
For all things Jermaine Andre, get books, get trained, learn the secrets behind his brawn, his brain, and his edge. Visit JermaineAndre.com. Life Fight with Jermaine Andre is another positive production of Rare Gem Productions. Thanks for listening.